These are seeds, small, apparently insignificant armor-plated structures. Seeds are humble capsules, but inside them, hidden in this apparent simplicity, the life of the jungles of the world strongly beats. The Earth is, to date, the only planet in the known universe that houses life. But life, something we still do not understand in its incredible complexity, is not a linear, singular, and absolute phenomenon, but rather an infinite series of circumstances that come together to create the miraculous balance giving pulse and continuity to the heartbeat of the planet. We are beginning to understand that the Earth behaves like a living organism, a fabulous, complex being composed of thousands of species, ecosystems, and physical and chemical, geological and atmospheric balances. Even the smallest beings play a role of incalculable value, and that is both the greatness and the fragility of our world. However inexhaustible life seems, it depends on structures and small beings, millions of tiny pillars that constitute the foundations of life, turning our planet into a rarity among the stars, a blue patch in the endless darkness of the cosmos, a living world in the dead immensity of space. Our species is experiencing unstoppable growth. Every day we are changing the world, adapting it to our needs, altering our natural parameters in such a way that even our biology, our animal essence, which out of some kind of complex we stupidly ignore, is suffering the consequences. There are now over 6,000 million of us, and by the middle of the century, it is calculated that there will be 3,000 million more. This makes us a destructive force comparable to the great cataclysms that caused the massive extinctions of prehistory. We demand that our needs be met immediately. We are the only species which, instead of adapting to its surroundings, is capable of altering them in order to adapt them to our needs. And this, which has permitted growth and expansion never before experienced by any species, has turned us into the greatest threat for our planet. We are changing the world at a speed never before seen since the time it was created. What began as small alterations have turned into drastic changes on a worldwide scale. Changes that are altering the landscape, extinguishing species, making entire ecosystems disappear, and changing the composition and properties of our atmosphere. And the Earth is starting to show signs that it's reaching the limit of its capacity to resist. Lies dead in the interior of the Amboseli National Park in southern Kenya. The park wardens remove its tusks. This is a measure that avoids the illegal traffic in ivory, a trade which, until it was banned in 1989, accounted for 80% of all the tusks sold in the world. The demand in Asian countries is a permanent threat for the elephants, a demand only held in check by an absolute ban on this trade. Even so, there is an unfinished war in which important battles have been won, but the enemy refuses to lower its guard. Countries like Zimbabwe, South Africa, China, and South Korea apply pressure to be able to sell their surpluses. But as soon as even a tiny amount is legalized, the poachers will take advantage and invade the market with tusks obtained in illegal killings. The case of the elephants is the best example of the struggle for survival of the threatened species. They are Pacific giants, but their size and their complex social structure have become a tragedy. In a land of limited resources, herds of elephants confined in restricted areas can cause terrible devastation. The dry season is a period of want in the savannas of East Africa. The majority of the herbivores migrate to higher lands in search of pasture, following a cyclical, annual, and unalterable route. For thousands of years, the elephants did the same, following routes that were passed down from generation to generation. But today their migrations takes them out of the parks, and their old routes now have new masters who cultivate them and protect them. The Maasai are not at all fond of the elephants. They are a cattle-rearing people who are beginning to cultivate the lands, and the elephants eat the pasture of their cows and destroy their crop fields. The new generations have forgotten the peaceful coexistence of centuries, the respect their ancestors felt towards these colossus of the savannah, and those who once shared the pastures have now become irreconcilable enemies. Today, the elephants are, sadly, an anachronism in a world in which every square meter of land has an owner, and where their enormous food requirements have become a threat for farms, cattle, and human populations. Their future, like that of so many other species in danger of extinction, now depends on the very same species that took their lands from them, killed their brothers to get their tusks, confined them in tiny strips of land where they are isolated, and so lose their genetic vigor. This elephant, wounded by a Maasai, came to die in the park. It was perhaps seeking out the only free hectares we have left them, to find its final rest there. Our world is becoming too small for us. Human population is constantly growing. There are millions of us all seeking food, shelter, and benefits from the land and the water. The majority of human beings are poor and live in underdeveloped countries, and so have no time to worry about the environmental problems deriving from their activity. That is a luxury they cannot allow themselves in the daily struggle for the survival of their families. And that is the great challenge that humanity faces, especially those of us that live in developed countries, To make the environment compatible with the needs of the so-called third world, millions of people who must ensure their food supply and their future. A small plot of land from which to obtain a crop is an invaluable treasure for the majority of humanity. These poor populations are in the countries that still conserve the last virgin territories on the planet. So when they burn or cut down in order to clear land for cultivation, they do so in areas of very high biodiversity, hotspots of world ecology. The pressure of these poor populations, which seek to cover their most elementary needs, directly affects ecosystems that house the last paradises in our overexploited world. And some of them, the most sensitive, are disappearing at a frightening speed. Scientists consider the tropical jungles to be the great treasure house of global biodiversity. Today they cover barely 6% of the surface of the Earth, but they are home to half the species known to man. For scientists, it is clear that it'll be here in the jungles that the fight to save biodiversity will be won or lost. In this fight, what is at stake is the future of thousands of species, many of them unknown. Those responsible have very little time in which to avoid the disaster. We have now destroyed over half the original forests of the Earth. 60% of the temperate and mixed forests have been lost. 30% of the coniferous forests have been cut down. 45% of the rainforest is now wasteland. And 70% of the dry tropical forests have been cut down or burnt, losing forever animal and plant species from which we could have obtained important knowledge. The tropical plants contain substances from which man has extracted medicinal compounds since his distant origins. When a species disappears, it takes with it substances that could have given us the drugs to cure our most deadly diseases. Every corner, every niche contains its secrets. The animals too, many of them yet to be discovered, contain substances that could cure us, feed us, help us make our work easier. Plants and animals jealously guard secrets for which we would pay fortunes. And nonetheless, while we extinguish species in our search for imaginary remedies for impotence and poisoning, we scorn this knowledge which once, in our origins, we had learned to obtain and which the last dwellers of the jungle still conserve. The natives of the tropical forests consider themselves to be living encyclopedias of the natural pharmacopoeia of the jungles. They know the secrets of thousands of species, but as they do not have writing in which to pass on their knowledge, It is transmitted orally from generation to generation. But when the jungles are cut down, the natives disappear with them, and the ancestral information of the remedies of the jungle is lost forever. The loss of the jungles has consequences beyond land biodiversity, affecting the very pillars of life on Earth. Because the jungle is responsible for the equatorial rains and their existence directly affects the water, the climate, and the atmosphere of the Earth. And nonetheless, man stupidly and blindly continues to destroy his benefactor. In the countries of Southeast Asia, the logging companies destroy the forest in search of tropical woods. In Central America and the Amazon basin, it is the cattle breeders in search of pasture that burn and cut down the jungles. But the greatest problem are the farmers living in poverty. 200 million people burn and cut down the forests in search of land for cultivation. Without agricultural techniques, the land gives one or two crops and is then useless. Then the tropical rains, without the natural contention of the jungle, carry the soil off. And what was once a paradise of biodiversity becomes a desert impossible to ever regain. There are places in the world where the evolution of species followed independent paths, giving rise to unique species, endemisms linked to an exclusive habitat that set out on a solitary journey with an island when they separated from the continents, or reached its coasts on floating islands over the course of the centuries. Madagascar is one of these places. When Madagascar separated from the African continent 165 million years ago, the species that undertook this solitary journey became independent from the rest of the world. None of them had any contact with the new species that arose by a natural selection and competition between the inhabitants of the rest of the world. Madagascar separated from the world, and its passengers lived a happy retreat from brutal selective competition. Today, the descendants of those involuntary shipwrecks have given rise to extraordinary beings, animals and plants that are completely different from those of the rest of the planet. These Madagascan species, biological treasures that can teach us the basic models of a different evolution, have made Madagascar a treasure of biodiversity, a natural wealth of incalculable importance. But the same singularity that makes the island so valuable has also made it an incredibly fragile place. Here, every niche, every small exclusive world, be it a tree, a patch of ground, or the interior of a plant, may contain species that exist nowhere else on Earth. And Madagascar, more than any other place on Earth, demonstrates the intricate dependency of all the members of each ecosystem. A dependency that makes each and every species vital. Deforestation is problematical in the whole world, but in Madagascar, the loss of the jungles is an irreversible tragedy. No other jungle can replace the species that are lost on this island laboratory. Each animal, each plant, is a unique experiment of an evolution that did not follow the models of the rest of the planet. In Madagascar, natural selection played by other rules, with its own predators and its own prey. For the lemurs, a group of proto-simians exclusive to this island laboratory, the only natural danger is an equally exclusive hunter, a fossa, an agile carnivore endemic to Madagascar. Hunters and prey arose from the balance of the same evolutionary process, a process that required millions of years to achieve the miracle of a different world in which life and death came together, sustained each other, and became mutually vital, permitting their continuity. The arrival of man in Madagascar 2,000 years ago threw dark shadows over a world forbidden to outsiders, and the balance of millions of years collapsed. Many species have become nocturnal in a final desperate attempt to survive. Today, all of them are threatened by man. Since our arrival, half of the Madagascan jungles have disappeared, and at least 2 dozen large animal species have been extinguished with them forever. The islands of independent evolution are thus fragile worlds, threatened by our species. And Madagascar is by no means the largest of them. Million years ago, when the supercontinent Gondwana broke apart, an immense piece of land set out on a solitary journey northwards. This enormous island that we now know as Australia would permit the survival of extraordinary, unique groups of mammals. The isolation of Australia permitted the diversification and expansion of a group which the placentary mammals did not allow to prosper in the rest of the world, and would also permit the survival of another group of mammals in clear decline, a group so old that though they are mammals, they lay eggs. As a result, Australia became the land of the marsupials and the monotremes, a world of different mammals unknown in the rest of the world. But its isolation would not last forever. Like Madagascar, Australia was also eventually discovered by man, though in this case much earlier. Man disembarked on the southern continent approximately 50,000 years ago. Those first aborigines proved to be respectful towards the nature of their new land. Their gods were reflected in the animals and plants of the Terra Australis, arousing respect and admiration which they skillfully transmitted in their paintings. Earth is the mother, and men who owe their lives to her venerate, respect, and protect her. That was the teaching of an ancient people which was passed on from generation to generation. But despite his veneration and respect for the natural environment, man became the origin of profound changes. When it arrived in Australia, our species brought with it powerful weapons of destruction that would bring an end to the peace and isolation of the island continent forever. Man learned how to use fire and acquired the destructive power of the storm and lightning. New hunters brought new, more efficient, and more deadly weapons. And the arrival of the Aborigines was accompanied by new species, new animals, hunters that were the result of the brutal competition in the other continents. Australia would undergo major changes, but these came gradually and nature was able to absorb the impact. But today, when man is recovering his interest in and respect for the nature he has been destroying for centuries, Australia faces a new, invisible, and devastating threat. The world of modern man has an insatiable need for energy. We have all become dependent on constantly growing energy consumption. The problem arises from an uncompleted process. Because we have learned to obtain and use energy, but we do not know what to do with the toxic waste generated by energy consumption. At first, we did not think this contamination was important, but the unstoppable increase in contaminating emissions is poisoning our world so much that its fabulous self-cleaning processes are unable to cope. Now the contaminating gases are changing the climate of the planet. And it is in places like Australia that we are starting to see the terrible repercussions this may have worldwide. Northeast Australia is protected from the pounding of the sea by the greatest barrier reef in the world. Millions and millions of tiny coral polyps have, with their calcareous skeletons, helped form a barrier of 348,700 square kilometers, the structure so incredible that it can be seen from space as a beautiful white line in the blue immensity of the ocean. The Great Barrier Reef, whose formation began 25 million years ago, houses the most diverse ecosystem on our planet. It is not an ecosystem rich in nutrients, but every corner, every nook and cranny, every opportunity provided by the intricate labyrinth of coral becomes an ecological niche taken advantage of by thousands of exclusive species. The 2,500 reefs that make up the Great Barrier Reef in Australia form a stable ecosystem that has maintained continuity over extremely long periods of time. For thousands of years, only gradual changes have altered this submarine world, and the result of this situation is unprecedented biodiversity. The coral reefs constitute the oldest natural communities on our planet. It is a deceptive world of disconcerting colors and shapes, where there are plants that look like animals, and animals that could easily be mistaken for plants. They all depend on each other, and fish and invertebrates take advantage of everything they can obtain from their neighbors. Here, among the infinite nooks and crannies of over 400 different species of coral, life multiplies in each and every one of its types. from tiny single-cell algae that live in symbiosis with the polyps, to marine mammals and powerful hunters of the sea that occupy the top of the food pyramid. All this explosion of life, this entire range of incredible biodiversity, is the result of an evolutionary continuity unaltered for millions of years. The reward for constancy, the patent demonstration of the biological potential of our planet. But starting just a few years ago, this biological continuity has suddenly been altered. And what appeared to be an unchangeable world has seen its ancient foundations crumble. The corals of the Great Barrier Reef have begun to bleach. Some external factor is killing the polyps, interrupting the growth and renewal of the reefs. And if the polyps are not renewed, the entire ecosystem simply dies. All the biodiversity of the ecosystem is based on the most delicate, tiny organisms of the reef, the coral polyps. These small architects are responsible for the construction and renovation of the Great Barrier Reef. And for this, they produce over 100 million tons of calcium carbonate a year. This production serves to repair the inevitable wear and tear of acting as a break on the sea and generate sufficient limestone to construct 17 pyramids like that of Giza. But in order for the polyps to construct their fabulous calcareous armor plating, they need the zooxanthellae, single-cell algae that live inside them and thanks to which they are able to feed. The zooxanthellae, represented here by the brown spheres, are vital for the growth of the corals, but they have a problem. They are incredibly sensitive to changes in temperature, and that is where our contamination comes in. The global warming of the atmosphere caused by contaminating gases is heating up the water of the seas. This increase kills the zooxanthellae, causing the death of the corals. And without corals, the coasts of northeast Australia will be left defenseless against the brutal pounding of the waves. We are changing the climate of the planet. The global warming of our atmosphere is a fact. Our climate is gradually heating up. The glaciers are retreating. The poles melting. We are causing a global change of magnitudes similar to those that mark the great extinctions of prehistory. And paradoxically and sadly, we are in great measure doing so by burning fossil fuels derived from oil, which are hidden beneath some of the last virgin refuges of unspoiled nature. In a world in which man has taken over most of the land, Alaska is one of the few remaining refuges for wildlife. An extreme climate marked by very low temperatures and 6 months of perpetual night makes the territories of the north a forbidden place for the majority of human settlements. And until now, this has been the life insurance of hundreds of animal species that live in a fragile, rich balance during the months of spring and summer, in which the climate of Alaska declares a truce. With the arrival of the warm months, Alaska comes back to life. All the species must take advantage of the days free of snow and ice to regain energy, reproduce, and accumulate reserves for the following Arctic winter. Some, like the salmon, return to the rivers where they were born after a long season growing and storing fat in the sea. Others, like the grizzly bears, come out of their dens where they have spent the winter in a state of lethargic hibernation and take advantage of the reserves of the salmon to satisfy their hunger of months. It is a season of surpluses in which the species synchronize their life cycles so that life is possible here where the climate imposes almost insuperable restrictions. And once again, the fragile network of interspecies dependencies makes the miracle of life possible. Towards the interior, and as we move further north, the vegetation becomes increasingly scarce. The tundra gradually gives way to the taiga, vast extensions covered in sparse vegetation, adapted to a soil permanently frozen beneath the surface. Here, resources are so limited that there is virtually no margin for error. The few days on which there is food available must be taken advantage of, and even the slightest source of energy plays a role of vital importance. And that is what makes Alaska, like all the lands of the Arctic region, an extremely fragile place, where all these species live at the very edge of the impossible, adjusting their lives and adapting their biologies so that they complement each other. It is, more than any other place, an extraordinarily synchronized world, so dependent on these scarce resources that a small alteration could destroy the entire system. But that would not be too worrying if it were not for the fact that underneath this apparently poor land, there lies huge reserves of oil. An enormous pipeline runs across Alaska from north to south, from Prudhoe Bay to the Valdez coast. 1,300 kilometers of pipeline to transport the 20,000 million barrels, which is the estimated production of Prudhoe. The companies try their best to achieve clean extraction, but experience tells us just how easy it is to inflict irreversible damage on such delicate ecosystems. The Exxon Valdez catastrophe was a warning from which the Alaskan coast has still not recovered. The death sown by the 36,000 tons of crude oil spilled continues to claim victims 13 years later. And the Exxon accident was a mere drop in the ocean compared to the overall figures, because it is estimated that in routine operations of the oil industry, every year between 3 and 4 million tons of crude oil are spilled. Until now, the extreme temperatures of Alaska have meant that extracting the oil that lies hidden in the ground has not been profitable. But while new technologies are eliminating these technical limitations, The world's greed for energy places pressure on industries and governments to undertake new prospections. And in Alaska, one of the last virgin refuges of Arctic flora and fauna, the day is fast approaching on which the petrol companies will destroy its fragile, vital balance forever. We are changing the world. We are altering ecosystems, changing landscapes, wiping out species at a speed 10,000 times greater than that required by nature to make new creatures appear. Man is the new vector of change as meteorites and continental drift were in the past. And in this global process, we are all contributing to the change. Immersed in an artificial world that we have created, we now look at nature from a new perspective, which makes us see that the world has its limitations. In response, our more advanced societies, with the best will in the world, promote initiatives to protect and conserve the last remnants of virgin nature. But playing at being gods shows just how complex the network of life is, and how complicated it is to move even a single piece of the intricate natural equilibrium. The Valdez Peninsula on the east coast of Patagonia in Argentina was once a center of the whaling industry. For decades, the harpoon ships devastated populations of the southern right whale until they were on the very edge of extinction. And then our species took a step back and remedied its mistake. Since 1983, the Valdez Peninsula has been a sanctuary for the large southern cetaceans. Here, the large right whales rest and reproduce, and their numbers have gradually risen. But in our pragmatic world, conservation is only possible if it brings income for the populations of the places in which it is practiced. And so, along with the creation of the national park, a tourist industry was also developed. And this has proven to be very lucrative. So far, so good. But in this process, there were some elements that were not taken into account. And one of those was the seagulls. Seagulls and some other marine birds, such as the skuas and petrels, are great opportunists. Along the southern coast, they take advantage of all the existing food resources. And in an entirely natural way, they have fed on fish, bodies thrown into the sea, mollusks, and in the breeding season, the chicks and eggs of a number of marine birds. These resources were limited, and this in turn limited the populations of these opportunists of the sea, until tourism arrived in Valdez. Today, there are so many seagulls which attack the large whales, ripping flesh from their backs, that the cetaceans have been forced to change their behavior. The growing numbers of tourists led to immediate growth in the towns and villages adjacent to Valdez. The hotels, inns, restaurants, and craft shops multiplied, but no one controlled the waste produced by them. And large waste dumps grew alongside the new settlements. These waste dumps became an inexhaustible source of food for seagulls and skuas, and their populations grew alarmingly. And today, paradoxically, the seagulls have become the greatest danger for the protected whales of the Valdez Peninsula, forcing man to seek new solutions. Playing at being gods has always been a temptation our species has been unable to resist. We use, change, and upset the natural balances at will, and in time, when we want to correct our errors, we realize just how complex the natural balance we have altered is. This is Yellowstone National Park in the west of the United States. Today, Yellowstone is a sanctuary for wildlife where the animals live in freedom, multiplying their populations away from the growing development of the greatest world superpower in an apparently unchanging ideal balance. But nothing could be further from the truth. Yellowstone was the first national park in the world. Here the foundations were laid for the creation of a network of sanctuaries to preserve nature from the unstoppable advance of man. And in the case of Yellowstone, to save an emblematic American species from extinction, the American buffalo. Man was on the point of wiping out this species, and man managed through Yellowstone to save it from extinction. But when the park was created, old enemies came face to face. Yellowstone is surrounded by cattle breeding territory, and no one was fond of the most important predator in the reserve. An animal that could kill domestic cattle, and which in nature was the only one capable of hunting the buffalo, the wolf. Despite its new status as a national park during the first decades after its creation, the wardens of Yellowstone persecuted and decimated the wolves. And playing at being gods, in order to save one species, they wiped out another one inside the protected area. In time, scientific knowledge has revealed surprising data. Not only had the wolves not wiped out the buffalo in Yellowstone, in fact, they favored the health of its populations. With the disappearance of the wolf, coyotes proliferated within the park, assuming the role of the main predator. But the coyotes were able to do very little to control the populations of large herbivores. And plucking up its courage in an exemplary manner, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service undertook the difficult task of remedying its mistake. Today, the gray wolf has returned to Yellowstone. Overcoming infinite difficulties and local opposition, the great predator has returned to its original prairies. And the first effects were rapidly seen. The populations of buffaloes, American elk, and mule deer are recovering their genetic vigor. The coyotes, whose numbers threaten different local species of birds and rodents, have returned to their original populations. And the ecosystem, altered so many times by man, has returned to something more like its original balance. Today, the wolf of Yellowstone is now a symbol of hope, a demonstration of how our mistakes can be put right. We have changed the planet, devastating our surroundings and playing at being gods in a world whose functioning we do not really understand. But we have also reached a cultural, moral, and scientific development that is leading us to correct mistakes. And new winds of hope are starting to blow in a world that needs help, and where the very future of our species is at stake.